quantum spin number. The I value is a very important parameter for the nucleus, and I value can be calculated based on the atomic mass and atomic number of the nucleus. I determines the number of orientations a nucleus may assume in the presence of external magnetic field. The number of orientations a particular nucleus may assume in the presence of magnetic field is given by 2i plus 1. For example, for proton, I value is 1 by 2. Therefore, using the formula, the number of orientations of a proton will assume when it is present in a strong magnetic field is given by 2 into 1 by 2 plus 1, that is nothing but 2. That means it will have two orientations. One orientation is known as alpha and the second orientation is as beta. In the absence of external magnetic field, all the protons will be in their random orientations. But once we place the proton sample or sample containing the protons in an external magnetic field, there will be two orientations for the proton. One is called plus of orientation, second one is called minus of orientation. And in one orientation, in alpha orientation, the spin of the nucleus will orient in the direction of the B0, whereas in the beta orientation, it will oppose the magnetic field. These are the two spin states, one is plus of and second one is minus of. And the splitting takes place only in the presence of B0. In the absence of B0, all the protons will be in the same spin state. When we supply the energy in the form of radio frequency, then the protons which are present in the alpha state will undergo a transition to beta state. This is basically absorption spectroscopy. Therefore, what will happen is the protons which are in the alpha state will absorb the radio frequency and will undergo a transition to beta state. The energy difference between the two states is given by delta I, and this energy difference is very, very low, and the population difference is also very low. For every 1 lakh protons, only one proton will be accessed in the alpha state. And the difference between the energy two states, delta I, is given by h by 2 pi into gamma into B0, where gamma is a very important parameter. And this diagram explains the what will happen when the applied magnetic field B0 is used. When the sample is placed in the B0 field, then the proton, being a small like a tiny magnet, will undergo positional motion to withstand that field. Therefore, it will undergo positional motion, and the axis is as indicated in the diagram. This is the axis of the spin, whereas this is the axis of the position. That means, like a positional top, the proton in the presence of strong magnetic field will undergo the precession, and the precession frequency is given by omega. Whenever the precession frequency is equal to the applied frequency, then the resonance phenomenon occurs, and the proton in the alpha state will undergo a transition to beta state. This is a block diagram of the NMR spectrometer. We will take the sample in this particular tube. Generally, the NMR tube diameter will be in the range of 5 millimeters, and this tube is inserted in between the two magnets. Generally, we use electromagnets or superconducting magnets based on the field strength that is given in Tesla, and we apply a radio frequency, and the radio frequency will enter and will leave the the absorption signal will leave the instrument like this. The energy difference is given by the following formula. This is one of the fundamental equations of the NMR. And gamma is a constant for each nucleus. It is known as gyromagnetic ratio. And the gamma value will depend on the mu value of the nucleus. For each and every nucleus, there is a intrinsic mu value. When it is based on the nature of the nucleus. And gamma determines the extent of splitting between the two states alpha and beta. For example, for proton, the splitting will be different, and for C13 nucleus, the splitting will be different. The extent of splitting between the two states will depend on the gamma value. And the precession frequency, the frequency with which the proton will undergo precession motion in the presence of external magnetic field, will be determined by the magnetic field strength that will be given in Tesla. As the field strength B0 increases, the precession frequency will also increase. For a better understanding, we can find that 60 MHz frequency is equal to 60 million times per second. That means the proton in the presence of 1.4 Tesla external magnetic field will undergo 6 crore times per second pressure motion. Now I will explain the concept of shielding. So far we have discussed that whenever a proton is kept in a magnetic field B0, then based on the field strength B0, it will undergo pressure motion. But we cannot find a naked proton or a isolated proton in a molecule, because in a molecule the proton will be surrounded by the bonded electrons. We know that in a molecule there are bonds between the atoms, and the bonded electrons will shield the nucleus from the external magnetic field. And like the protons, electrons also will undergo a particular motion in the presence of a magnetic field B0. Because of the circulation of the electrons in the presence of magnetic field, a second magnetic field is generated. This is known as induced magnetic field. And this induced magnetic field will generally oppose the B0, that is the applied magnetic field. This is the nucleus, and this is electron density surrounding the nucleus. And because of the circulation of the electrons which are surrounding the nucleus, there is a second magnetic field, and the second magnetic field is opposing the B0, which is applied magnetic field. And because of the shielding, we have to make a modification to the basic equation of the NMR. Previously, we have discussed that the pressure frequency or the applied frequency will be given by gamma into 1 by 2 pi into beta B0. But we have to now modify. Instead of B0, we have to now take B effective. And B effective is given by 1 minus sigma into B0, where sigma is the shielding constant, and which explains the extent of shielding offered by the electrons surrounding the proton. The greater the shielding, the lower the pressure frequency. Now I will define the concept of chemical shift. In NMR, we won't take the incentric frequencies of the protons. That means incentric absorption frequencies of the protons. What the absorption frequency, what we will observe will be the relative frequencies with reference to a reference proton. Therefore, the chemical shift may be defined as the difference in the absorption position of a particular proton from the absorption position of the reference proton. The reference proton generally we take in the NMR experiments is TMS, that is tetramethyl silane. Because TMS is having several advantages. It is soluble in most of the organic solvents. It is having low boiling point. Therefore, it can be separated easily from the sample once the experiment is carried out or once the spectrum is recorded. And the chemical shift is indicated by delta, and the units are generally given in ppm. Therefore, the delta is a ratio which can be defined as shift in the frequency from the TMS peak divided by the frequency of the NMR spectrometer, which is given H into 10 power 6. So, what does ppm represent? For example, if you take a 60 MHz instrument, then all the units will be in the order of 60 MHz. First unit will be 60, second will be 120, third one will be 180, fourth will be 240, like that. If you take 100 MHz instrument, the first unit will be 100, second unit will be 200, like that. Therefore, the ppm will represent the absorption frequencies of the different protons, and it will depend on the operating frequency of the instrument. For example, if you take a 60 MHz instrument, the first ppm will be 60 MHz. Whereas in 100 MHz instrument, 1 ppm will be equal to 100 H. These are the hydrogen chemical shifts or the proton chemical shifts for different types of function groups or molecules. The COH group will be having high delta value, whereas alkenes and alkynes will be having low value. And the aliphatic compounds will have a value in the range of 0.5 to 1.5, like that. And for different types of protons, I have given the delta values. Now we will go to the NMR spectrum. NMR spectrum is basically a plot between the frequencies of the absorption peaks and their intensities. And from NMR spectrum, we will get information regarding the position of the peaks, and how the protons are coupled with other protons, how many protons are there give rise to a particular peak like that. The integration is a very important factor here. The integration of a peak will give the idea about the number of protons which are giving rise to that particular peak. Therefore, by integrating, we will get the area, and the area will depend on the number of protons giving rise to that particular peak. Therefore, the number of signals will show how many kinds of protons are there. The location of the signal will give us an idea about whether the proton is deshielded or shielded when compared to TMS. And the intensity of the signal will give the number of protons. And the spin splitting will give an idea about how many protons are surrounding a particular proton and coupling with the proton of interest. There are three important factors that will affect the chemical shift. One is the deshielding offered by the alternative elements. Second is an anisotropic effect, which is generally observed in aromatic systems and the systems having pi electrons. And third one is the deshielding, which is due to the hydrogen bonding. Whenever an alternative element is attached to the carbon atom which is containing the proton, then as shown in the diagram, the electron density surrounding the proton will decrease. Whenever the electron density surrounding the proton will decrease, the proton will be deshielded. That means the field experienced by the proton will increase as the electron density surrounding the proton decreases. Therefore, the more the deshielding, the lower the field, that means the greater the delta value. And this gives an idea about the effect of alternativity on the chemical shift. As the alternativity of the element attached to the carbon atom containing the proton increases, automatically the delta value increases. Because as the alternativity of the element increases, then the bonded electrons, electron density of the bonded electrons surrounding the proton will decrease. And the more the number of highly alternative elements, the more will be the delta value. For example, CsCl3 will be having a delta value of 7.27, which because it contains 3 chlorine atoms, whereas methyl chloride CsCl contains only 1 chlorine atom. Therefore, its delta value is only 3.05. Now, let us discuss about the anisotropic effects. As I mentioned before, anisotropic effects are mainly due to the pi electrons, because the pi electrons will undergo a circulation in the presence of the strong magnetic field and will generate a second magnetic field. And this secondary magnetic field or induced magnetic field will be anisotropic. That means the magnetic field will be uniform, will not be uniform around the different regions of the proton. It will be diamagnetic in certain regions, it will be paramagnetic in certain regions. And the protons in the diamagnetic field are generally shielded, whereas the protons in the paramagnetic field are deshielded. And generally this effect is generally observed in the benzene rings. Let us consider the ring current effect in benzene. We know that in benzene molecule, there is a 6-pi system, and because of the 6-pi system, there is a ring current effect, and due to the circulation of the pi electrons, there will be a magnetic field, and this magnetic field will be paramagnetic in the plane of the molecule, whereas in the regions above and below the plane of the molecule, this will be diamagnetic in nature. Therefore, the protons which are present above and below the benzene ring will be shielded, whereas the protons which are present within the plane are deshielded. And all the benzene protons are present in the plane, therefore they are more deshielded. The same effect can be found in the case of alkene. In the case of alkene, there is only one pi bond, and the pi electrons will undergo circulation, and induced magnetic field will be generated, and this induced magnetic field will be deshielded, will be paramagnetic in certain regions and diamagnetic in other regions, and the alkene protons are in the deshielding region. That means they are in the paramagnetic region. Therefore, the delta value will be more. Whereas in the case of alkyne, the alkyne protons are in the diamagnetic region. That means they are in the shielding region. Therefore, when you compare the delta values of alkenes and alkynes, you can find that alkynes are having low delta value, because in the case of alkynes, the protons are present in the shielded region. Now, let us discuss the effect of hydrogen bonding. Whenever hydrogen bonding takes place, then the lengthening of the bond occurs. that means the OH bond will be lengthened. That means the bond length between the oxygen atom and hydrogen atom will increase. Because of the increase in the bond length of this bond, the bond will be weakened. As the bond weakens, automatically what will happen is the electron density surrounding this particular proton will decrease. As electron density surrounding the proton decreases, automatically what will happen? It will be deshielded. Therefore, the delta value will increase. Generally, the dicarboxylic acids will be in the dimeric form or trimeric form. Because they are in the dimeric form, the delta values will be more, because the hydrogen bonding will be strong, and because of the hydrogen bonding, they are deshielded. The same is observed in the case of methyl salicylate. Here, delta values are nearly in the range of 14. Now, let us discuss the concept of chemical shift equivalent protons. The protons which are having the same or identical chemical shift values are known as chemical shift equivalent protons. How we can find the chemical shift equivalent protons? Whenever the protons are interchangeable by a rapid process or by any symmetry operation, we have several symmetry operations like rotation about an axis, reflection from a plane, or inversion from a center. In any of these symmetry operations, if we can interchange the positions of the protons, then we can say that all the protons are chemical shift equivalent protons. That means they are having the same delta value. For example, in the case of methane, we can find that all the four protons are having the same delta value because it is having TD symmetry, highly symmetrical molecule. Therefore, we can interchange the one proton position with the other proton like that. Therefore, it is having the delta value. It is having the same delta value. If you observe the spectrum of methane, then we can find only one peak, because all the four protons are giving only one peak. They are having the same chemical shift, and it is observed at a value of 0.4 delta. The same is the case of ethane. In the case of ethane, we are having two methyl systems, and there is a C-C bond connecting the two methyl systems. And the protons in the one methyl system can be interchanged by the protons in the other group or other system. And therefore, by symmetry operation, we can interchange the positions of these protons. Therefore, all the six protons present in the two methyl groups are having the same delta value. That means all the six protons are chemical shift equivalent protons. And we will observe a peak in the spectrum at 0.9 delta value. Now, let us take the case of ethyl bromide. In ethyl bromide, we are having two types of protons based on the chemical shift, because the methylene protons, that is CH2 protons, are near to the electronegative atom, whereas the methyl protons are far away from the bromine atom, that is the electronegative atom. Therefore, now there are two sets of protons. One is methyl protons and second is methylene protons. All the three methyl protons indicated as B are having the same delta value, whereas the two methylene protons indicated by HA will be having the same delta value. Therefore, in the NMR spectrum, we can see two peaks, one peak corresponding to the methyl protons, other peak corresponding to the methylene protons. Now, let us go to the concept of magnetic equivalent protons. Magnetic equivalent protons are also known as spin coupling equivalent protons. And then how we can define the magnetic equivalent protons? If the chemical shift equivalent protons, that means the protons in the same set undergo coupling equally to any other proton or proproton in any other set, then we can say that there is a magnetic equivalence. The magnetic equivalent protons are nothing but chemical equivalent protons, whereas chemical equivalent protons may or may not be magnetic equivalent protons. How we can find the magnetic equivalence? The magnetic equivalence can be determined by using the bond relationships. That means we have to determine the bond distances and bond angles between the proproton and the protons which are having the same chemical shift value. If the bond distances and bond angles are same, then we can say that the two or three protons in the same set which are having the same delta value are magnetic equivalent. That means they will not undergo coupling with one another. It can be better explained by taking the example of ethyl bromide. As you see in the diagram, there are two sets of protons, the methyl protons and the methylene protons. The methyl protons are having the one delta value, which is different from the methylene protons delta value. Now, the three methyl protons, which are indicated as HP, will undergo the coupling to the same extent with the HA proton, which is a proproton. That means we have to choose a proproton from the other set. for methyl protons, HB protons, the proproton is HA, whereas for the methylene protons, the proproton is HB. Therefore, for the all the three methyl protons are having the are at a same bond distance compared to the HA, the proproton. Therefore, the three protons, the methyl protons, will not undergo coupling with one another. In the same way, for these two methylene protons, this is the proproton, and the two protons will undergo coupling to the same extent with the three HB protons. Therefore, the two HA protons will not undergo coupling with each other. That means they are magnetic equivalent protons. Now, let us consider the concept of coupling constant. Therefore, how much extent the coupling takes place can be determined by using a constant known as coupling constant, and they are independent of the applied field strength. If the coupling occurs between two bonds, that means if the coupled protons are separated by two bonds, then is known as geminal coupling. If the protons which are undergoing coupling are separated by three bonds, as in this case, that is known as vicinal coupling. Here the number 2 or 3, that is the number which indicates the number of bonds which are actually separating the two protons. The coupling beyond three bonds is generally known as long range coupling, and it occurs generally in the case of alkenes, and aromatic compounds and heteroaromatic compounds. As I mentioned already, the coupling constant values are field independent. That means whether you take 100 MHz instrument or 200 MHz instrument, the J values will be same, whereas the delta values will vary. That means the shift values will vary from instrument to instrument. Okay. Now, let us consider the concept of geminal coupling. Geminal coupling is indicated by JGEM, and the values are generally in the range of 10 to 18 H, and the alternativity has an effect on the geminal coupling values, and the magnitude of the JGEM values will depend on the bond angle, and generally it will be high in the case of the rings which are having less strain, and as the angle strain of the ring increases, the J values will decrease. And as I previously mentioned, vicinal coupling occurs whenever the two coupled protons are separated by three bonds. Generally, the JVis values will be in the range of 0 to 12 H, and the influence of dihedral angle on the J values can be better explained by using Karplus equations. And this particular diagram will represent the effect of the dihedral angle on the coupling constant. Whenever the coupled protons are separated by more than three bonds, that is known as long range coupling. And long range coupling generally occurs in allylic systems and in aromatic systems. Whenever allylic coupling occurs, it will be in the range of 0 to 2H, and in the case of meta coupling, the value will be in the range of 2 to 3H, whereas in the case of para coupling, it will be in the range of 0 to 1H. Generally, the J value will be high in the alkane system whenever there is a W conformation. Now, let us consider the concept of spin-spin splitting. Spin-spin splitting occurs because of the coupling of the one proton with the other proton. That means, spin-spin splitting is a result of the spin-spin coupling, and the splitting will depend on the number of neighboring protons, and it is given by the formula N plus 1. We can make use of the Pascal's triangle to explain the intensities of the peaks in a multiplet. If there is only one proton, we will get a singlet. When one proton couples with another proton, then we will get a doublet in the ratio of 1 is to 1. Whenever one proton couples with two protons, then we will get a triplet, three lines in the spectrum in the ratio of 1 is to 2 is to 1. Whenever a proton couples with three protons, then we will get a quartet based on the formula N plus 1, 3 plus 1 equal to 4. Therefore, there will be four lines in the spectrum in the ratio of 1 is to 3 is to 3 is to 1. Like that, we will get several lines in the peak. That means the peak will be undergo splitting based on the number of neighboring protons. These are some of the common splitting patterns. Based on the neighboring protons, we will get the doublet or triplet. Now, let us consider the spin-spin splitting in ethyl bromide. In ethyl bromide, there are two types of protons. We already discussed that the methyl protons being chemical shift equivalent and also magnetic equivalent will not undergo coupling with one another. In the same way, the methylene protons also will not undergo the coupling with each other. But the methyl protons will undergo coupling with the methylene protons. In the same way, methylene protons also will undergo coupling with the methyl protons. Therefore, the multiplicity of the peak due to methylene protons is given by 3 plus 1 equal to 4, because the methylene protons are undergoing coupling with 3 methyl protons. Therefore, number of Nyquist protons in the case of methylene protons is 3, whereas in the case of methyl protons, number of Nyquist protons is 2. Therefore, we will observe a triplet. As shown in the NMR spectrum, the peak corresponding to methylene protons will contain 3 lines in the ratio of 1 is to 2 is to 1. Whereas the methyl protons contain three lines in the ratio of 1 is to 2 is to 1. Whereas for the methylene protons, we will have a quartet in the ratio of 1 is to 3 is to 3 is to 1. In the case of NMR spectrum of 1, 1, 2 tribromoethane, there are two types of protons. One is the methane proton and second one is the methylene proton. Here for the methane proton, the number of Nyquist protons is equal to 2, therefore we will get a triplet. Whereas for the methylene protons, number of Nyquist protons is 1, therefore we will get a doublet. Now we will see how the J values will explain the splitting. For example, the protons of interest, for example, these methylene protons will undergo coupling with two different types of protons. That means these protons are coupled strongly and these protons are coupled less strongly with these protons. And the high value of J will indicate that these protons will undergo coupling to a stronger extent with these protons and compared to these methylene protons. In such a case, we have to use the formula n1 plus 1 into n2 plus 1. First, the methylene protons will undergo coupling with the protons on the protons which are having the, with which they are having the J value of 7. Then we will get a triplet, and each leg in the triplet will be further split by the other protons in the other set. That means with these protons. Now we will get each line in the triplet will be split into a triplet. That means we will get a triplet of triplets, triplet of triplet. That means we will get 9 lines in the spectrum. Now let us consider the NMR spectrum of the ultra pure ethanol. In the case of ethanol, there are 3 types of protons. One is hydroxy proton, second one is methylene proton, third one is methyl proton. The methyl proton will undergo coupling with the methylene protons, n equal to 2, therefore we will get a triplet. Whereas the methylene proton will undergo coupling with the hydroxy proton and also methyl protons. Therefore, 3 plus 1 into 1 plus 2, therefore we will get 8 lines in the spectrum. Whereas for the hydroxy proton, it will undergo coupling only with the methylene protons. Nyquist protons equal to 2, therefore 2 plus 1 equal to 3, we will get a triplet as shown in the NMR spectrum. Now let us go to the Popple notation. The protons which are having the same chemical shift are placed in one set, and each set is designated by a capital letter, capital A, capital B or capital X, like that. And the notation will depend on the value of the delta V by J. What is delta V? Delta V is nothing but the difference in the chemical shift between the two sets of protons, and J is the coupling constant. And if the delta V by J value is greater than 8, then we will get a first order spectrum. If it is, the example for the first order spectrum is as shown in the figure. Here, the chemical shift value can be obtained from the medium position, midway or midpoint of the two lines. Here also we can get the chemical shift value from the midpoint. Whereas in the case of, this is the example for the AX system, that is transcinnamic acid. We can calculate the J value based on this particular formula. If you multiply the difference in the chemical shift between the two peaks with the operating frequency, then we will get the J value. For example, in a 200 MHz instrument, each ppm corresponds to 200 H, and the difference between these two peaks will be, in a doublet will be, these two peaks in doublet is 0.09 delta. Therefore, when you multiply this delta value 200 H, you will get a 18 H value, and 18 H value indicates that transcoupling. That is, coupling J values for the transcoupling will be in the range of 12 to 18 H, whereas cis coupling will be in the range of something like 6 to 12 or 14. Then this is example for the A2X system. Here we are having the methylene protons and also methane protons. And if the value of delta V by J is less than 8, then we will get non-first order spectrum. In the case of non-first order spectrum, we cannot get the shift positions directly from the spectrum. We have to use the center of gravity of the two lines. We cannot take the midpoint. This is the midpoint of the two lines, but we have to take the center of gravity, which is close to the peak having highest intensity. And the delta V value is calculated by using the formula as shown in the slide. And as the J value decreases, what will happen is, as the J value decreases, what will happen is the distance between the internal peaks will decrease, and the automatically we will get a we will move towards the non-first order spectrum. And ultimately, when the delta J value becomes 0, the two lines will coalesce, that means they will combine, and the outer lines will vanish, then we will get the A2 spectrum. Therefore, in NMR spectroscopy, so far we have discussed about the some basic important concepts like chemical shift, factors affecting chemical shift, what is coupling, how the spin-spin splitting takes place, what are the factors that will affect the coupling. Thank you. Now, I will discuss about the EPR spectroscopy. In this particular presentation, I am going to discuss about the basic concepts of the EPR spectroscopy, how EPR spectroscopy is related to NMR spectroscopy, what are the common principles for the two different types of spectroscopy techniques. EPR, that is electron paramagnetic resonance spectroscopy, is also known as ESR, that is electron spin resonance spectroscopy. It is an important spectroscopy technique for the study of the paramagnetic species. We all know that paramagnetic species contain unpaired electron. Whenever there is unpaired electron in the system, whether it is a metal complex or it is a molecule or is a radical, then we can identify these systems using EPR. It is a very, very important tool to study the systems having the unpaired electrons. Whereas the diamagnetic substances contain the paired electrons and they cannot be studied by using ESR. That means we cannot get a ESR spectrum from the diamagnetic substances. So, what are the commonly encountered paramagnetic species? As I mentioned already, organic free radicals, metal complexes, triplet states of the diamagnetic species, and some molecules like NO, NO2, ClO2. And EPR was discovered by Javorsky, a Soviet physicist, in the year 1944. In fact, he has recorded the first EPR spectra of copper and manganese complexes using a home-built spectrometer. As I mentioned already, NMR spectroscopy and EPR spectroscopy share some fundamental principles. Like NMR spectroscopy, EPR spectroscopy is also based on the resonance phenomena. In the case of NMR, the dipole which is produced by the proton will interact with the primary magnetic field B0 and also secondary magnetic field in the form of radio frequency pulse. In the same way, in the EPR, the dipole which is produced by the unpaired electron will now interact with the B0 and also the radio frequency. The electromagnetic radiation we use is the microwaves. Now, let us compare the basic equations operating the NMR and EPR. In the case of NMR, the basic equation is as we already discussed. The operating frequency nu will depend on the B0, a sigma will indicate the shielding constant because there will be electrons surrounding the proton in a molecule. In the same way, for the EPR, the operating frequency is given by G into beta into B0, where beta is an important parameter known as Bohr magneton. It is like the gamma in NMR. Like gamma in NMR, it determines the extent to which the two spin states of the proton will electron will undergo splitting. In the case of NMR, there will be two spin states for the proton. One is indicated by second one is indicated by minus of beta state. Whereas in the case of electron, like proton, there will be two spin states, but the lower energy spin state is indicated by minus of, whereas the upper high energy spin state is indicated by minus of. And this diagram indicates a splitting pattern in the case of NMR and EPR. As you can compare, in the case of NMR, the two states are close to each other, whereas in the case of EPR, the splitting is more. Generally, the splitting in the case of EPR will be more in the nearly more by 150 times. That means the two spin states of the electron are separated to a larger extent when compared to the two proton spin states. And this slide will give the information about the basic differences between the two types of spectroscopy techniques. Generally, in the case of NMR, we use the B0 in the form of Tesla, whereas in the case of ESR, we use a lower field strength magnetic field. In the case of NMR, the frequency will be in the range of H, that is one in the range of 60 MHz or 100 MHz, like that. Whereas in the case of EPR, it will be in the area of microwaves. That means the frequency will be higher, and the separation between the levels is more in the case of ESR, as we already shown in the previous slide. Whereas in the case of EPR, there will be one electron in excess for every 700 electrons. Whereas in the case of NMR, only one electron will be excess for every 1 lakh protons. That means it clearly indicates that the electrons are more sensitive to the magnetic field when compared to the protons. And NMR spectra are commonly recorded as absorption spectra, whereas the EPR spectra are recorded as either first order or first derivative or second derivative spectra, because the energy difference between the two states is very small and the population difference is also very small. To improve the signal to noise ratio, we generally record the spectra as first derivative or second derivative curves. Like in NMR, there are two important parameters in EPR. In NMR, we are having two important parameters. One is the chemical shift delta, and the second one is the coupling constant J. The analogous parameters in EPR are, one is G value, second one is hyperfine interaction. First, I will discuss briefly about the G value. G value indicates the interaction between the unpaired electron and the applied magnetic field B0. And G values are analogous to chemical shift values. The G value for a free electron will be 2.0023. The electron is generally not free in a molecule. It is bound to the molecule, and therefore the chemical environment surrounding the electron will influence the G value. But for most of the organic radicals, it will be near to the 2. For all organic based radicals, it will be near to the G value, that is free electron G value. And the G value of the paramagnetic species generally deviates from the G value. Generally, the G value will deviate to a greater extent in the case of metal complexes, that is the transition metal complexes and lanthanide complexes. And G value is more diagnostically more important in the case of metal complexes when compared to organic free radicals. Now, let us discuss about the hyperfine interaction. This is analogous to the coupling constant in NMR. In the case of NMR, the coupling is due between the two protons. The protons having different chemical shift values. Whereas in the case of EPR, the splitting occurs because of the coupling of the unpaired electron spin with the spin of the surrounding protons, which are generally within the range of 5 angstrom units. The protons and C13 nuclei, N14 nuclei are some of the nuclei generally which will undergo interaction in the molecules with the electron. And the G values are generally given in the units of Gauss, that is field strength. And in the same formulas can be used to explain the splitting as in the case of NMR. Here we use the formula 2Na plus 1, where N indicates the number of protons which are surrounding the electron, and I will indicate the spin quantum number value. In the NMR spectroscopy presentation, I have given the I value for different types of protons, that is different type of nuclei. We can make use of those values to arrive at the number of lines. This is the ESR spectrum of the hydrogen atom. We know that hydrogen atom is the only atom which contains only single electron, therefore unpaired electron. Therefore, we can have the NMR spectrum of the hydrogen atom. and the dotted lines will indicate that there is will be only one line if there is no coupling between the electron, the single electron and pair electron and the surrounding nucleus. But the surrounding nucleus will undergo coupling, therefore we will be having two lines. We apply the formula 2ni plus 1, n equal to 1 and I equal to 1 by 2 for proton, therefore we will get the value of 2. And the coupling constant value, that means here the hyperfine value is very high, which is equal to 507 Gauss. This is the ESR spectrum of the methyl radical. In the case of methyl radical, there are 3 protons which are surrounding the unpaired electron. Therefore, using the formula, we will get 4 lines, and the 4 lines will be in the ratio of 1 is to 3 is to 3 is to 1, and the coupling constant value will be in the ratio of 1 is to 3 is to 3 is to 1, which is indicated by this particle pyramidal analysis. Now, let us see the ESR spectrum of the ethyl radical. In the case of ethyl radical, there are 2 types of protons. One is the protons which are near to the radical, that is methylene protons, and other protons, methyl protons, which are in different chemical environment, which will also couple with the radical. Therefore, now there are 2 different sets of protons, and then therefore the formula will be n1 plus 1 into n2 plus 1, therefore we will get 12 lines, and as indicated in the diagram, there will be 2 coupling constants, one with the methylene protons and another with the methyl protons. The values are as shown in the diagram. This is the benzoquinone radical. In the case of benzoquinone radical, there are 5 ring protons which will couple with the radical. Therefore, n plus 1 equal to 6. There are 4 ring protons. Therefore, n equal to 4. Therefore, there will be until 5 lines. And the coupling constant value will be 5 Gauss. Therefore, in this presentation, I have discussed about some basic concepts of the EPR, how EPR can be correlated to NMR spectroscopy, what are the common principles both the different spectroscopy techniques will share, and the 2 important parameters of the EPR spectroscopy. One is the hyperfine splitting indicated by A, and second one is the G factor. Thank you. Now I discuss about the infrared spectroscopy. In this particular topic, I am going to give emphasis on the spectral analysis, how an IR spectrum can be interpreted, how we can get the information from the IR spectrum. Before going to that, I will discuss some basic concepts of the IR spectroscopy. We know that IR radiation will be in generally range from 100 centimeter inverse to 10,000 centimeter inverse. And IR spectrum, we will observe the bands instead of the lines, because we know that each vibration line in a molecule will contain several rotation lines, and whenever a vibration transition occurs, it will be accompanied by several rotational transitions. Therefore, in vibration spectra, we will get the bands, and each band contains several lines. And the important region for the organic chemistry point of view is 4000 centimeter inverse to 400 centimeter inverse. That means most of the spectra are recorded in this particular region, because most of the organic compounds, or almost all organic compounds, will give absorption peaks within this particular region. What is the basic principle of EPR? The IR spectroscopy. The IR spectroscopy is based on the principle that each and every chemical bond has a intrinsic vibration frequency. No 2 different chemical bonds are having the identical intrinsic vibrational frequency values. Therefore, we can make use of this particular point, and we can detect the bonds in the organic molecules by identifying these intrinsic frequency values as absorption bands in the IR spectrum. And we know that the chemical bond will be like a spring between the two balls. Therefore, it will be having the flexibility, it will undergo vibration. The vibration may be simple harmonic or anharmonic. And the vibration frequency is given by this particular formula. If the vibration frequency is represented in H, then nu will be equal to 1 by 2 pi root k by nu, where nu will indicate the reduced mass as given in the formula. Whereas, if the vibration frequency is expressed in wave numbers, generally in IR spectroscopy, we will make use of the wave numbers instead of the wave frequencies. And nu is indicated as nu tilde, and nu tilde is equal to nu by c, equal to 1 by 2 pi c into square root of k by mu. It should be pronounced as nu tilde, not as nu bar. And this is a common IR spectrum. In the IR spectrum, on the left hand side on the spectrum, we will be having the transmittance values, which will be given the percentage values. And on the right side, we will be having the absorbance values. On the bottom of the spectrum, we will be having the wave number values, that means nu tilde values, whereas in the top of the spectrum, we will be having the wavelength in the form of micrometers. There are three important regions in the IR spectrum. One is fingerprint region, second one is aromatic region, and third one is functional group region. In the fingerprint region, no two different molecules will give the same absorption pattern. As given in the diagram, we know that n-pentane and n-hexane, okay, differ only by a methylene group only, because pentane will be having the formula of C5H12, hexane will be having the value of C6H14. There is only a difference of CH2 in the formula. But we can see in this particular spectrums, in this particular region, which is known as the fingerprint region, there is a difference in the absorption pattern, whereas in the other regions, the absorption pattern is almost same. Therefore, by concentrating on this particular region in the spectrum, we can able to find whether the compounds which are yielding the two different spectra are identical spectra. Then let us now have a look on the molecular vibrations. There are two types of molecular vibrations. One is stretching vibration, second one is bending vibration. And stretching vibration occurs due to the rhythmical movement along the bond axis. Whenever the bond undergoes the stretching vibration, there will be change in the bond length. Whereas whenever there is a bending of the bond, then there will be a change in the bond angle. And the stretching will require more energy when compared to the bending of the bond. And the molecular vibrations can be classified into two types, stretching, bending, and bending are again classified into two types, in plane, out of plane. And in plane vibrations are again classified into scissoring, rocking, whereas out of plane, or also known as OOP, are classified into wagging or twisting, whereas stretching vibrations are classified into symmetrical and asymmetrical. And this particular animation will give the idea about the different types of stretching modes. See, in the case of symmetrical stretching, there is a uniform change in the bond angle, whereas in the case of anti-symmetric stretching, the bond angle will be not be same, variation in the bond angle will not be same in the two bonds. Whereas in the case of rocking, the two bonds will move in the same direction, inward or outward. Whereas in the case of wagging, there is a to and fro motion. The two bonds will move towards the observer or away from the observer, from the plane of the molecule. Whereas in the case of twisting, one bond will move towards the observer and one bond will move away from the observer, like this. And number of fundamental vibrations can be determined by using the formula 3n minus 6 in the case of nonlinear molecule, whereas in the case of linear molecule, it will be 3n minus 5, where 6 is due to the 3 translation degrees of freedom and 3 rotation degrees of freedom in the case of nonlinear molecule, and the number 5 is due to the 3 translation degrees of freedom and 2 rotation degrees of freedom in the case of the linear molecule. For a water molecule, which is a nonlinear molecule, based on the formula, we will be having 3 fundamental vibrations. For CO2 molecule, there will be 4 fundamental vibrations. And we know that all the vibration modes will not give rise to the IR spectrum. Only those vibration modes in which there is change in the dipole moment value, they will give the IR spectrum. For example, if you take the stretching vibration of CO2 molecule, the stretching vibration, there is no change in the mu value. the permanent dipole moment value of COD is 0. When you stretch the bonds to an equal extent or compress the bond to the same extent, then what will happen is there will be no change in the mu value. Therefore, this particular vibration modes, that means out of the 4 vibration modes for CO2 molecule, the stretching vibration mode will be IR inactive. There are certain molecules like homonuclear dianion molecules O2, N2, H2, which are having mu value of 0. Therefore, they will not give IR spectrum. They are known as, they are not the greenhouse gas. That means why they are not greenhouse gas? Because they are not absorbing the IR radiation. And this is an anharmonic oscillator. And we know that whenever the bond undergo vibration, it will behave like an anharmonic oscillator. And the selection rules for an anharmonic oscillator are delta V equal plus R minus 1, plus R minus 2, or plus R minus 3. Whenever the transition occurs from 0 to 1, that is the ground state to first excited vibration state, that is known as fundamental frequency. From 0 to first second excited state known as first overtone, third excited state known as second overtone. And generally the more number of bands are observed in the spectrum when compared to the fundamental vibration bands. That means if you do see the spectrum of CO2 molecule, we have to observe only 3 bands, but more than 3 bands are observed because of the combination bands and difference bands. The vibration frequency of a bond will change as the bond strength changes or the reduced mass of the system decreases. As you see, for CC single bond, CO single bond, the frequencies are in the range of 1300 to 800 centimeters. Whereas for the double bond systems, the values are more. Whereas for the triple bond systems, the values are even more. Let us now discuss the IR spectra of alkanes. For alkanes, we will observe a stretching frequency of CH bond in the range of 2850 to 2960. Whereas for the bending, also known as def, that is the deformation bands, will be in the range of 1350 to 1470. For if there is a methylene system in the alkane, there is a methylene moiety in the alkane, then we will observe a peak in the range of 1430 to 1470. If there is a methyl moiety, then we will observe in the range of 1375 and also in the range of 1430 to 1470. Whereas for isopropyl system, we will observe the values like this. Now let us discuss one example. For n-pentane, we are having a CH2 system. Therefore, we are getting 2 peaks, one at 1470, one is at 1375. And this is a non-aromatic system. Therefore, for non-aromatic compounds, we will get the CH stretching frequency below 3000. Therefore, by looking at the spectrum, we can find whether the spectrum is of the aromatic compound or of the non-aromatic compound. For non-aromatic compounds, we will observe the CH stretching below 3000 only. Whereas for the aromatic compounds, we will observe the CH stretching above 3000 centimeter inverse. This is for the 2-methyl butane. This contains isopropyl system. Therefore, we will observe the band in the range at 1370 and 1385. That means we are getting a couple. That means they are getting 2 bands, which are almost close to one another at 1370 and 1385. This is for 2,3-diethyl butane. Now let us consider the case of benzene. I already discussed it. In the case of benzene, we will observe a CH stretching above 3000. That means in the range of 3000-3100 centimeter inverse. For mono, that means by looking at the IR spectrum, we can find whether the benzene molecule is monosubstituted or orthosubstituted or metasubstituted or parasubstituted. In addition to the CH stretching, we will have CH deformation values. That means by looking at the CH bending values in the aromatic region, we can find whether it is monosubstituted, ortho, meta or parasubstituted. This is the spectrum of ethyl benzene. As you can see, we can observe a spectrum above 3000 centimeter inverse in the range of 3000 to 3100 centimeters in the ethyl benzene spectrum. Therefore, by looking at the spectrum, we can find that it is a aromatic compound. And it is also monosubstituted because we are getting the peaks in the range of 690 to 710 and 730 to 777. That means we are getting a doublet-like absorption bands. For orthoxylene, the spectrum will be like this. For the paraxylene, the spectrum will be like this. Like that, we can determine whether the compound is ortho, meta or para. Therefore, in this particular presentation, I have discussed about the basic concepts of IR spectroscopy, how the vibration frequency will change based on the nature of the bonding, how we can determine the number of vibrations in a molecule, what are the fundamental vibration frequencies of different types of bonds, how to determine whether the compound is aromatic or non-aromatic by looking at the spectrum. Thank you.